The fundamentals have all remained the same. So once you get your basics right, the procedure gets easier on its own. In modern day FACO, the chamber stability is a given standard, and you are all blessed with all the new innovations, just like your mobile phones and smartphones, you know, and all the high-end cars. So when we learned, it was like in U2, Universal 2 and Millennium, where, you know, we had to just literally sit on the foot pedal to get these preset parameters. But anyway, our reflexes and tissue handling got better with those machines. So now let's get into the FACO basics to have an elementary introduction. And I would request the seniors to have to share their experiences towards the end of the talk. Over to you, Amulya.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Amulya from, I'm second year primary DMB. This class is on basics of FACO emulsification. Moderators of this class are Dr. Veena Bhaskaran ma'am and Dr. C.K. Parameshwari ma'am. So FACO emulsification procedure was first invented by Dr. Charles D. Kelman. The FACO emulsification comprises of two elements. First is ultrasound energy that is used to emulsify the crystalline lens. And then the fluidics, this is used to counteract the potential heat buildup by the ultrasound energy and also to counteract the repulsive action of the FACO probe. And this fluidics also removes the emulsate via aspiration port while maintaining adequate depth and pressure in anterior chamber. So what are the parts of FACO machine? There is console. Console is the monitor which controls and displays all the various parameters, that is power, vacuum or flow rate. What you see in the picture is the console or the monitor. There is handpiece. Handpiece are of two types. One is FACO handpiece, one is irrigation aspiration handpiece. There is foot pedal, irrigation circuit, and aspiration circuit. This is a schematic representation of FACO machine. In the figure you see, this is an irrigating fluid reservoir. This is connected to the handpiece via the irrigation line. And the irrigating fluid comes through the irrigation port into the eye and then aspirated via the aspiration port into the handpiece and then into the pump, and the fluid is drained. This is the foot pedal. Foot pedal is divided into main central part and sidekicks. Can you see my cursor, ma'am? As the cursor is placed, this is the central part of the foot pedal. These are the sidekicks. The main central part is divided into three excursions by two dentations. This central part controls infusion, aspiration, and FACO power. The main function of the sidekicks is reflux. What is reflux? When you kick the side switch, the aspiration flow is inverted and the material is aspirated and expelled into the AC. This is very important because whenever we catch any unwanted structure like iris or posterior capsule, it can be reflexed back into the eye. There are two feedback mechanisms. One is tactile feedback mechanism. Tactile feedback mechanism is that the resistance is felt at the dentations while you change the position of the foot pedal. The auditory feedback is the sound that machine makes while changing position. So we should be familiar with the auditory feedbacks while changing the positions of foot pedal. The main central part has three positions. First is a position zero. It is the resting position. There is no fluid that is coming into the eye. Then position one. In position one, the pinch valve opens and the irrigation occurs with the effect of gravity depending on the height of the infusion body. In position two, the irrigation is fully on and the aspiration flow rate increases as the foot pedal is depressed. In position three, there is irrigation, aspiration and FACO. Irrigation is fully on, aspiration and vacuum is at its maximum preset value, and FACO power keeps on increasing with the depression of the foot pedal.
One second, Amulya.
Yes,
can anyone say what is a foot gradient? Foot gradient?
Yes,
Alavi? Who is speaking?
Foot gradient is the amount of amount of the angle that the foot depresses.
Yes.
In
Amulya, can anyone say? I think you have read it. Pallavi, Ganesh, anyone can say that?
It is the amount of power that is delivered by each excursion, like each mm of excursion.
No, it's on not the power.
Angle, it's ma'am, depending upon the angle, the amount of peco we deliver.
No, foot gradient is the excursion of foot pedal in millimeters to produce unit power of peco energy. So if you like, if you foot grade, if you like 100 millimeters foot power, you foot pedal you press for 100% of energy, there will be 1 millimeter unit of for 1 millimeter unit of excursion, 1 unit of power. So decreasing the peco power, and also it will give 1 unit for 2 millimeters of excursion. And the same way, if you put 25% of peco power, there will be 4 millimeters of foot excursion for 1 unit of power. So always in the foot console, decreasing the maximum preset power on console increases the foot gradient and also the foot control. Okay, carry on, Amulya.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. This is the peco handpiece. Peco handpiece has three ports which can be connected to three lines. One line is the ultrasonic power line which delivers the electric energy to the handpiece. The other two lines are aspiration line and irrigation line, which are present coaxially. Then a hollow titanium tip is fitted onto the handpiece body. There is a silicone sleeve covering the tip. In the silicone sleeve, there are two holes which are 180 degrees apart, where the irrigation, from which the irrigation goes into the eye. And the infusion occurs within the space between the body and the sleeve. Then how the electrical energy going to the handpiece is converted into mechanical energy. There are two types of handpiece, piezoelectric handpiece and magnetorestrictive handpiece. Now magnetorestrictive handpiece is obsolete. Now all are piezoelectric handpieces. Piezoelectric handpiece contains 2 to 6 crystals. Then the electric energy is delivered to the handpiece. The crystals reorient themselves. Due to this reorientation, it is transferred into oscillations at the tip. Then mechanisms of FACO. There are two mechanisms of FACO, jackhammer effect and cavitation effect. What is jackhammer effect? Jackhammer effect is a mechanical force that is created due to the forward movement of the tip. This mechanical force breaks the lens material. This also causes repulsive action of the free floating lens material. Next effect is cavitation. Due to to and fro movements of the handpiece, there is intense high and low pressures. So as you can see in the figure below, when the withdrawal of FACO tip occurs, there is vacuum created in front of the tip. Due to this vacuum, the gases that are present in the solution come out and they form gas bubbles or micro bubbles. And then when the second cycle of compression occurs, there is intense high pressure due to which micro bubbles implode. Due to this implosion, heat and shock waves are produced and the nucleus is disintegrated. So FACO is the combined effect of both jackhammer and cavitation. Nowadays, there is torsional FACO also, which eliminates the jackhammer effect and the repulsive action of the free floating lens material. FACO power. FACO power depends on stroke length and frequency. What is stroke length? Stroke length is the distance by which the tip moves in longitudinal axis in each oscillation. So you can increase the stroke length by increasing the FACO power. Frequency. Frequency is the number of forward and backward movements made by the FACO tip in unit time. Frequency is fixed for each mission. So it will be between 29 to 60 kilohertz. So you can change the FACO power by changing the stroke length of the handpiece. There are various types of FACO needles. FACO needle is basically a hollow titanium tip that is fitted onto the handpiece. It is of two diameters. As you see in the figure, there is 19 gauge standard tip, which is around 0.9 mm internal diameter. And there is 21 gauge micro tip, which is around 0.6 mm internal diameter. What are the advantages of the micro tip? Micro tip can be fitted through small incision and there will be more fluidic resistance, which prevents surge. I will be talking about surge later. And the disadvantages are there is less holding power due to less diameter, and also there may be blockage of the pathway by the nucleus. The various needle tip designs are: there is standard tip, Kelman tip, balanced tip, microflow tip, taper tip, flat tip. So I'll explain about flat tip. So flat tip is combined 19 gauge and 21 gauge, means at the distal tip of the needle the diameter is same of 19 gauge, it is 0.9, but at the proximal shaft of the needle it is 0.6 mm. So it is advantage of both standard and micro. It means it delivers more power, it can hold nucleus more at the tip, as well as prevent surge. This is another tip, microflow tip. It contains grooves that are cut into the outer surface of needle shaft. Due to this groove, there are irrigation channels. It means there is continuous flow in the port. This also prevents surge, and also there is thermal protection. This is standard straight tip. This is Kelman tip. What is Kelman tip? Kelman tip is angulated at the distal side. This angulation produces more of torsional effect, means sideways movement, which prevents jackhammer effect and more shaving action. This is the, as you see in the figure, this is the Kelman tip, which is angulated. And there is balanced tip. Balanced tip is S-shaped. It has two bends at the tip.
Okay. Basically, going back to the tips, one second. This is a balanced tip. That is, there is two curves at the end of the tip, which if you see, the bevel is at the in line with the shaft, which means the thermal conductivity is not straight to the shaft and to the needle, so the wound burns are little lesser in case of a balanced tip. Whereas in Kelman tip, it's a straight, it's a bent tip which conducts the heat directly to the wound. That is one added advantage of balanced tip than a Kelman tip. And because the bevel is at the same side of the, in line with the shaft, the holding power is also better with the balanced tip. And we don't endanger the capsule also more with the balance tip, and is very useful in case of the denser cataracts. Carry on.
Yes, ma'am. Coming to the bevel angles, there are different types of angles at the tip: 0 degree, 15 degree, 30 degree, 45 degree, and 60 degree. As the angulation increases, the cutting power of the tip increases. So 60 degree tip has the highest cutting power, and the 0 degree tip has the lowest cutting power, and the highest cutting and the holding power goes on decreasing as the angulation increases. So 0 degree has highest holding power. So most used tip is 30 degrees, which gives adequate cutting and holding power. These are the different types of phaco modes. Continuous mode. Continuous mode, there is linear mode and fixed mode. Pulse mode, burst mode, hyperpulse, and hyperburst mode.
One second, Amulya. Can anyone tell what is absolute phaco time? Absolute phaco time?
Yes, ma'am. Absolute phaco time is total amount of phaco that is delivered, ma'am. The total time for which the phaco is delivered.
Ashok, anyone who is there? Arun, Maitri,
ma'am, total time for which the preset power is delivered.
No, absolute phaco time is average ultrasound power multiplied by elapsed phaco time. Okay, for 15 seconds of 100% power, if you use the absolute phaco time is 15 seconds, and in the same way, if you use for 30 seconds 50% of power, 15 seconds is the absolute phaco time. Okay, so even if you use 25% of power for 60 seconds, the use is only 15 seconds of absolute phaco time. So It is directly related. Okay, if you decrease the power and increase the time, or increasing the time and decrease the power, so it is directly related. Okay, and anyone can say what is a FACO modulation? What is FACO modulation? Parth is there? MPK?
When changing of the FACO modes is modulation.
No. Any easy pitches I want to answer. Okay. Pallavi?
Ma'am, changing the modes that are prefixed on the console is called FACO modulation.
Okay, in a better way?
The FACO time actually can be reduced by delivering it in pulses or bursts.
Okay.
So that is FACO modulation instead of the continuous ultrasound that can be instead of pulses.
Yeah, correct, Angeli. So, using continuous FACO mode, the ultrasound energy delivered will damage the corneal endothelial cells and also cause corneal decompensation, because more power, more energy is used, and also the heat produced is very high, as long as 13,000 Fahrenheit. So, FACO time can be decreased by applying FACO power only when cataract pieces are at the FACO tip. And also, FACO time can be reduced by delivering shorter pulses or shorter bursts of FACO power instead of continuous ultrasound. So this is this method of breaking up ultrasound power into smaller packets of pulses and bursts is called FACO power modulation. Okay, Amelia, you can carry on. Proceed.
Yes. Coming to linear mode, it is a type of continuous mode. There is continuous supply of energy, but the FACO power can be varied by depression of foot pedal. As you see in the left side of the figure, here the preset FACO limit is 100%. So as you depress the foot pedal, the FACO power goes on increasing till 100%. That is preset power. In the right side, you can see preset limit is 50%. So as you go on depressing the foot pedal, the FACO power increases only till 50%. That is preset value. And panel mode. Panel mode is also one type of continuous mode. Here also there will be continuous supply of energy. But full preset power is delivered at the start of position 3. And as you depress the foot pedal, the FACO power is constant. So here the preset limit is 50%. So at the start of the foot pedal itself, it achieves 50% power and it is constant throughout. Before going to pulse and burst mode, I shall tell you about duty cycle and pulses per second. First, we'll get familiar with the terminologies of on period and off period. What is on period? On period is the duration of the time for which the FACO power is on. Off period is the rest interval. So in on period, ultrasound energy is delivered and the heat is generated. In off period, there will be no power, but there will be vacuum. So nuclear fragments are aspirated and there will be thermal relaxation time, that is cooling time. So what is cycle time? One cycle is one, as you see in the figure, one pulse duration plus adjacent rest interval. So it is on plus off period is one cycle time. What is percentage duty cycle? Percentage duty cycle is the proportion of on time relative to one cycle. For example, in the left of the figure, you see it is 50% duty cycle. It means for the 50% of time, that is orange pyramid, 50% of the time FACO is on and 50% of the time FACO is off. Suppose if it is 20% duty cycle, for 20% of the time FACO is on and for 80% of the time FACO is off. Then what is PPS? PPS is the number of pulses of energy that is delivered per second. As you see in the right, the x-axis indicates 1 second, that is 1000 milliseconds. If it is 2 pulses per second, it is divided into 4 halves. So 250 milliseconds power is on, 250 off, 250 power on, and then 250 off. So it means 2 PPS means it consists of 2 duty cycles. In the down figure, you see it is 4 pulses per second. It means 1 second, that is 1000 milliseconds, it's divided into 8 halves. 125 each. So 125 FACO power is on, 125 FACO power is off, and so on. coming to pulse mode. In pulse mode, energy is delivered in pulses. It is not continuous. So here, pulses per second is fixed. In traditional pulse mode, there will be max 20 pulses per second. And the FACO is energy is varied with the excursion of foot pedal. And traditional pulse mode has typically 50% duty cycle. As you see in the figure, here the preset FACO limit is 100%, 2 pulses per second and 50% duty cycle. So, as the foot pedal goes on depressing, the FACO power is increasing, but the pulses per second is fixed and the duty cycle is 50%, that is half of the time power is on and half of the time power is off. So, next comes burst mode. In burst mode, the FACO energy is fixed and the time between the burst can be modulated. That is, as you go on depressing the foot pedal, the off time goes on decreasing. And at the end of foot pedal, you'll have the energy as in continuous mode. For suppose here preset FACO power 50%. So as you go on, the FACO energy is at 50% only, but the off time goes on decreasing and it is continuous at last. So this shorter duty cycle gives thermal protection and longer duty cycles deliver more power. And what is hyperpulse and hyperburst mode? Hyperpulse and hyperburst mode, it has combined advantage of both pulse and burst mode. It means if you depress the foot pedal, the power changes and also the duration of cycle is shortened. And another advantage is, it can deliver up to 100 pulses per second, but traditional pulse mode can deliver only 20 pulses per second. And the burst duration in this mode can be as short as 4 milliseconds. Due to this mode, there is improved fallibility and also more thermal protection. Coming to fluidics of the FACO machine, it consists of two systems, infusion system and aspiration system. What is balanced AC dynamics? To maintain balanced anterior chamber, inflow, that is irrigation, should be equal to outflow. Outflow consists of both aspiration of fluid and also wound leakage. Infusion system. This infusion system, as you see, consists of irrigate, as I said before, it consists of irrigating bottle, which is connected to the FACO handpiece through irrigation line. The amount of fluid delivered, it depends on the height of the infusion bottle. So around for about 15 centimeters height above the eye, there is 11 mm Hg pressure created in the eye. So ideal IOP is 30 mm Hg, which is created by elevating the bottle 45 centimeters above the eye.
One second, Amulya.
Yes, ma'am.
So infusion system, what will happen if you keep the bottle height too high? Shruti is there. Shruti, can you answer? What will happen if you keep the bottle height too high?
Ma'am, IOP will rise.
Okay. Yeah, IOP will rise.
More pressure on the PC, more pressure on the posterior capsule and zonular zonules.
Okay. And then?
Because of the increased fluctuation of the iris length diaphragm, so it will irritate the iris and the pupil will constrict.
Okay, because AC has a fixed volume, so whenever you increase the bottle height high, there will be zonular stress and also fluctuation of the iris length diaphragm and also irritation of the iris. Okay, so ideally you have to keep at a 3 feet plus or minus one bottle hit. Okay, that will maintain the safe IOP. Okay, Amelia, you can proceed.
And also there is a indicator in the monitor console where there is a PEL, so the patient eye level, that has to be adjusted to the patient eye level. That indicates the infusion pressure which is provided, which is the difference between the bottle height and the infusion which you are giving into the eye. So you are always, before starting the case, it's better to keep the probe outside in the bag or in a saline syringe to check how much is your infusion pressure outflow which you are getting. And it has to come out like a fork from the two holes on either side, 180 degree away in the sleeve, and then you proceed with the surgery.
always check that the probe and the patient eye is at the level which is indicated in the console, so that it corresponds to the bottle height and the correct intuition pressure is delivered.
Yes, ma'am. Aspiration system. Aspiration system has two functions. First is lavage of the anterior chamber, and second is creation of a hold for emulsification of the nucleus. Lavage is governed by flow rate, and the hold is a function of the vacuum. What is flow rate? Flow rate is the quantity of fluid in CC that flows out of the eye through aspiration tubing per minute. The flow rate determines how well the fragments are attracted to the phaco tip. Vacuum. Vacuum is the negative pressure generated by the pump, which is measured in mmHg. It determines the holding power of the phaco tip. Rise time. Rise time is the time taken by the machine to reach maximum preset vacuum after complete occlusion of the tip has been achieved. There are two types of aspiration pumps. One is flow pumps, the other is vacuum pumps. In flow pumps, the most commonly used is peristaltic pump. It also has scroll pump. In vacuum pumps, the most commonly used is venturi pump. And the other vacuum pumps are diaphragm pump and rotary vane pump. So in peristaltic pump consists of a rotating wheel with series of rollers which are pressed against the silicone aspiration tubing. So how the outflow happens? When the rotation pump start rotating, the rollers pinch against the silicone tubing. Then a peristaltic wave develops in the tubing, which sucks the fluid out of the eye into the tube, and then it is drained into the soft drainage bag. Here, how is vacuum generated in this pump? As you see in the figure, when the handpiece tip is occluded by lens material, then there is the outflow basically stops as there is no space in the, as there is decrease in the exposed area of the tip. But still the rotating wheel continues and the fluid that is remaining in the tube is sucked out, and a negative pressure is created in the tube. As the tip occlusion continues, vacuum builds up and the rollers start slowing down. On complete occlusion of tip, rollers stop moving and vacuum is now at its highest level and the outflow is zero. This is how vacuum is generated in peristaltic pump. Now coming to venturi pump. Venturi pump makes use of compressed air or nitrogen. Here, the compressed air or nitrogen flows from an area of larger diameter to area of lesser diameter. While it flows to lesser diameter, the velocity increases and the pressure decreases. Due to the pressure gradient, low pressure, a vacuum is created in this channel that is transferred into the rigid drainage cassette and transferred into the handpiece to the tip. And then the lens material is sucked into the tubing. What are the differences between peristaltic and venturi pump? Peristaltic pump is flow based. Venturi pump is vacuum based. Peristaltic pump, vacuum is created only when the tip is occluded, but venturi is independent of occlusion. As I said earlier, rise time is the time taken by the machine to achieve preset vacuum. Here, peristaltic machine vacuum rise time is slow, because the remaining fluid should be milled out by the rotating wheel. And it also depends on the rotations per minute of the wheel. Here the vacuum rise time in venturi pump, vacuum rise time is quick. Flow rate and vacuum can be dissociated or controlled separately in peristaltic pump. Flow rate and vacuum cannot be dissociated. Flow rate depends on the vacuum in venturi pump. Peristaltic pump fluid is drained into a soft bag. Venturi pump fluid is drained into a rigid cassette. As the rise time is slow, peristaltic pump is better for a beginner. Venturi pump is better for an experienced surgeon. Surge. What is surge? Surge is the sudden withdrawal of fluid from anterior chamber after occlusion breaks. What is compliance? Is the property of tubing to deform under pressure. As you see in the diagram on the right, my cursor. So when the tubing is occluded by the lens fragment, negative pressure is created in the tubing. Due to this high negative pressure, if the tubing is more compliant, it can deform. So it deforms, and when the occlusion suddenly goes off, the tube suddenly rebounds. Now the vacuum becomes more, and sudden rapid exit of fluid takes place from the AC. So this can be prevented by making less compliant or rigid tubing so that they don't deform under negative pressure. Surge can be prevented by both machine and also by the surgeon. How it is prevented by the machine? As I said earlier, they can use rigid and less compliant tubings. They can use aspiration bypass system and venting mechanism, which I shall be discussing later. And in the machine itself, there may be delay in the start of the motor after occlusion breaks. And some machines have microprocessors which detect the start of the surge, and they automatically low down the flow rate and the vacuum rate. Surge prevention by the surgeon. The surgeon can decrease the aspiration flow rate and vacuum. He can increase the bottle height. He can use AC maintainer so that AC is maintained throughout. Or we can use high viscous fluid, because a thicker fluid cannot flow out easily from the tube. And there should be proper wound construction, that is watertight wound, so that leakage doesn't happen. What is venting? Venting is the process whereby vacuum is equalized to the atmospheric level of pressure. There are two types of venting, fluid venting and air venting. As you can see in this picture, when the vacuum is reached to its highest level and the tube is deformed, the vent valve opens and the air or fluid, whatever in the vent, it is drained into the tubing and the pressure becomes normal. So this prevents surge. Then aspiration bypass system. Aspiration bypass system, it is a flow modification of the tip. As you see in the figure, there is a small 0.175 millimeter hole in the needle shaft. This hole permits a path for the flow of fluid from the irrigation sleeve to the port. So there will be almost continuous fluid in the port, and this prevents surge. This ABS system can be kept into 0 degree tip or Kelman tip or flare tip.
One second. Yes, yes, yes. So we have seen what are all the methods the surgeon or machine can control the surge. And above all this, I want to add one thing, like good foot pedal control is very important in controlling the surge. As soon as the occlusion is about to break, the surgeon can lift the foot pedal to irrigation aspiration zero. Okay. By this, the fluid withdrawn from the AC is very less to overcome the complaints of the system. So balancing between aspiration flow rate, vacuum, and momentum of the pieces, that needs to be done very carefully. So it is ideal to bring the foot pedal to a position where the surge is decreased without breaking the momentum of the pieces, which is coming towards the tip.
Still faster, ma'am. It's already 5:30 and we have lots to go.
Okay, ma'am. Fallibility refers to the tendency of the nuclear fragments or cortical matter to come into the tip. So this fallibility is due to the pressure gradient developed at the tip. This pressure gradient leads to eddy currents from the infusion orifice to the phaco tip. As you can see in the figure, the green zone represents the zone of most fallibility, and the gray zone represents the zone of no fallibility in the subincisional zone, and the yellow zone represents the poor fallibility. So you can increase the fallibility in yellow zone by moving the phaco tip towards the yellow zone. Central safe zone. Central safe zone is an anatomical area for performing safe aspiration. This is area within CCC margin. It is bounded vertically by the cornea on the top and posteriorly by the posterior capsule. This is the area of maximal space in anterior chamber. So whatever epinucleus, cortex, whatever piece is taken into the central safe zone and then aspirated. The capsular fornices and the angles of eye determine the unsafe zones. So now let's talk about the phaco emulsification procedure. First, incision and wound construction. Ideal incision is sutureless, self-sealing, and it should be an astigmatic neutral funnel. What is astigmatic neutral funnel? Surgical induced astigmatism is directly proportional to the length of the lesion, length of the incision, and it is inversely proportional to the distance of the incision from the center of cornea. So the base of the funnel is at the limbus. It is 3 to 3.5 mm. And as it goes posteriorly, it flares out because as the length increases, the surgically induced astigmatism decreases. What is self-sealing incision? Self-sealing incision is made by creation of a corneal valve and by creation of square incisions. When, as you see in the figure, when the IOP develops, the inner lip is pushed against the dome of the cornea and the incision is sealed. The ideal length of the corneal lip is 1.75 millimeter with smooth edges. Side port incision. Two side port incisions are made with either 15 degree knife or MVR blade. It is made 2 to 3 clockers away from the main port, 180 degrees apart. It should be clear corneal and 1.5 cross 1.5 mm. Main port. Main port incisions are three types: clear corneal, limbar, scleral. Clear corneal is entry and the exit is both in the cornea itself. It may be incision can be taken superiorly, temporally, or along any steeper axis. Advantages of temporal incision is it is easy to manipulate in deep set eyes and it induces less astigmatism, less pooling of fluid, and maximum red glow. There are four architectures of incision. One is uniplanar, biplanar, triplanar, and hinged incision. In uniplanar, the incision is taken only in single plane. In biplanar, as the name suggests, it is taken in two planes. Triplanar incision is the most common incision used. The first incision direction is parallel to the iris. Then it is beveled up, and then it is beveled up and taken through the corneal stroma, creating a tunnel, and then the needle is turned and parallel to the iris, the AC is entered. This is a hinged incision. The first plane is more than the second plane. As the planes increase, the valve activity increases and the astigmatism also increases. Scleral incision. For scleral incision, first limited conjunctival peritomy is done, bipolar cautery is done, and scleral incision is made with 15 number blade. There are four types of scleral incision. One is straight linear incision, smile incision, frown incision, and chevron, that is arrow-shaped incision. Incision creates a groove. This groove should be 1/3 to half scleral thickness. And then crescent knife has rounded edge and rounded tip and sharp edges. It is placed under the incision made by the blade, and then it is moved parallel to the sclera in the center of the groove with sideways movement on either side, creating a tunnel till the cornea. Then keratome is inserted into the tunnel till the cornea, and heel of keratome is elevated, tip of keratome is pointed posteriorly, creating a dimple and entering into the AC. This is crescent knife, this is the keratome used. So, scleral versus corneal incision. In scleral incision, there is less chances of infection, more bleeding, difficult instrumentation, cannot be done under topical anesthesia, and as the length of the incision is away from the cornea, there is less astigmatism. Conversion is easier. In corneal, so there is more chances of infection, less bleeding, ease of instrumentation, can be done under topical, more astigmatism, and conversion is difficult.
One second, Amulya. Previous slide, please. Can anyone tell me the anatomy of the limbus, the surgical anatomy of the limbus? Anjali? Anjali, you are there?
Yes, ma'am. Hello. It starts from 1 to 2 mm from the anatomical limbus and the... Hello, hello.
It's breaking. Okay, Ganesh is there?
Hello.
Ganesh? Anjali, continue. You're not audible.
Yes, ma'am. Now is it clear?
Hello?
Yeah, tell.
Hello, ma'am.
One of your answers, Anjali, tell.
Yes, ma'am. It starts from 1 to 2 mm from the anatomical limbus, the bluish zone that we can see. That is the surgical limbus, and that's when you...
That's where you make the?
The tunnel, when you start putting the groove.
Oh, is it so? No, yes. No, so I just asked the anatomy of the limbus so that you know where and where the structures are ending. Where does the scleral spur, where does the Descartes membrane, where does everything end? What is the landmark?
I'm sorry.
She showed something called the astigmatic funnel, right? Where is the base
line.
Of the...
The blue line.
The surgical limbus is 2 mm. It starts from the limbus up to 2 mm. It has a blue zone and a white zone. So the blue zone is limited by anterior limbar border and middle limbal border. And from this, that is the end of blue zone. And from blue zone to the posterior limbar border, we have the white zone.
So,
yeah.
Funnel starts from the base of this limbus and extends flares posteriorly, and whatever decision lies within this astigmatic funnel is astigmatically neutral. And all clear cone incisions which are temporal are supposed to produce lesser astigmatism because probably against the rule astigmatism as we get elder. The elderly people have against the rule astigmatism. So the temporal clear corneal incisions are supposed to produce lesser astigmatism than the scleral superior incisions or clear corneal superior incisions. Okay, and again, the temporal clear corneal incisions are not covered by the lids, so more exposure and more chances of infection. That is what we get from this tableau. Okay.
Yes.
Next one. Yes.
Continuous curvilinear capsulorhexis. The prerequisites are: there should be flat anterior lenticular surface. The AC should be maintained. The AC should be deep, which is maintained by visco, moderate to good dilatation, good optimal visibility, and good red glow. So the instruments used are 26 gauge cystitome needle, which is mounted on 2 cc syringe or capsular forceps. The ideal size is 5 to 6 mm. The physics of the CCC is there is ripping force or stretching force, which cannot be controlled easily, and there is shearing force, which is more controlled. As you can see, first NIC is made in the center, radial incision made, and the flap is turned over. Now you hold at the base of the flap, and shearing force is created, and the flap is moved along the pupillary border centripetally. As the rexis progresses, the flap will enlarge and it may get crumpled. So you have to smoothen out before advancing. It is smoothened out, and again rexis is continued. Hydro procedures. There are two types of hydro procedures: hydro dissection and hydro delineation. The instrument used are 26 to 30 gauge hydro dissection cannula mounted on a 2 cc syringe. Hydro dissection is, as you can see, separation of the capsule from the cortex. What are signs of hydro dissection? If a fluid wave is visualized between the cortex and the capsule that goes on along the length of the cortex, and the red leaflets becomes dull, the nucleus pops up, and CC rexis margin also becomes little larger in size. For mature cataracts, the hydro dissections can be done in multiple quadrants so that corticocapsular adhesions are released. And then with that cannula, you give little compression on the lens so that the fluid trapped under it comes out. Hydro delineation. It is the separation of endonucleus from epinucleus. Mainly golden ring sign is seen, which tells that endonucleus is separated from the epinucleus. What are advantages of these procedures? There will be free rotation of nucleus, and there will be debulking of nucleus for phaco, and there will be safety cushion of the epinucleus during phaco emulsification of the endonucleus, limited posterior capsular opacification, as lens epithelial cells or detached from the capsule by hydrodissection.
One second, Amulya.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell what are the do's and don'ts in hydro procedures? Can others can say? Lavanya is there? Lavanya? Saurabh? What are the do's and don'ts in hydro procedure?
I'm trying not the 6 o'clock, initially the six o'clock, the inferior pole coming up.
Okay, in
Veko. Too much fluid, this thing, because inferiorly, if too much fluid, then there is no space to go, and then there is a more chance towards rent, because inferiorly the space is limited, so it should be pushed gradually and not in one go.
Okay, Lavanya. What is the main thing you do in hydro FECO? Lavanya is there? Tell me, yes.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, tell me.
Ma'am, the fluid should be injected just under the capsule.
Okay, first thing is always use the main port in FECO, okay? Main port should be used. And also, before that, remove if any viscoelastic is there, remove all the viscoelastics before doing the hydro. And also your focus should be below the CC so that you can see the fluid wave. And the cannula should be radial to the CCC and well inside the CCC so that whatever you are injecting that should not come into the AC. It should go back and form a fluid wave. Okay. And also what are the means when do we know that hydro dissection is complete? She already told. Lavanya?
The lens can be rotated.
Okay.
The golden ring we can see in soft cataracts.
That is for hydro delineation.
Shallowing of the AC.
Yeah, it is shallowing of the AC and the CCC also little gets stretched and the nucleus moves little forward. Okay, Amulya, proceed.
So, what are the techniques of nucleotomy? There are three techniques: divide and conquer, stop and chop, and direct chop. In divide and conquer, first we bare the nucleus, trenching is done, splitting, and then FECO aspiration. Baring means you repeat, you remove the anterior epinucleus and cortex. This is done is low power and moderate vacuum. Then trenching is done. Trenching is creating a groove in the nucleus in sculpt mode setting. The setting will be low vacuum, moderate flow rate, and high FECO power. This is the, as you can see here, this is the trenching. First, it is start at the center or just proximal to the center. And the tip is moved forward. By moving forward, there is shaving action. And to maintain this action forwards, the tip is just lifted up and the FECO handpiece is depressed using the incision as fulcrum and moved forward. And when the return, during the return stroke, never use FECO power or any aspiration. Just put it in position one. You have to trench until the red reflex is more visible. So ideally, the width of the trenching should be 1 to 1.5 tip diameters. Depth should be 2 to 3 tip diameters. Then you rotate the nucleus 90 degrees and again repeat the same trenching procedure. Then you split the nucleus. During splitting, the two instruments should be embedded deep into the trench and then split. Don't put it superficially. And during rotation and nucleus splitting, it should be done in only position one. That is only irrigation mode. Then the four quadrants and held and FECO applied to emulsify and aspirate in FECO in quadrant mode. These were the parameters: aspiration flow rate 25 to 30 cc per minute, vacuum around 100 mmHg, power 50%. This is the divide and conquer video by Dr. KKV ma'am, which will be explained by Dr. VBN ma'am. Ma'am, shall I play?
Yeah, please. Yeah, I thank Dr. KKV for such a beautiful video. This is how to start do divide and conquer. And start your trench from the middle and then go down with a FECO power of say about 30 to 40 and the vacuum of about 200 to 250. And once you've done with the initial trench should be short of the rexus, and then you proceed with the extending your trench. As you go deeper, you should get a more even red glow. And as you go to the periphery, turn the tip a little up so that you don't go at the same depth throughout. Towards the center, you can go a little deeper, and towards the periphery, you lift the probe a little. Once you achieve the entire all four quadrants by moving 90 degrees, we can get to crack once the proper depth is achieved, which is about 1 to 1.5 the tip diameter. Or if you are using the probe, it can be even 2 times the size of the tip. And go to the center and separate instead of going to the periphery where the nucleus is soft. The center part is only separated easily. Once the cracking is done, your quadrant aspiration is done, which I'll discuss later.
Okay. The next one is stop and chop technique. Here, trenching is done only in one axis. You stop the trenching there and you split the nucleus into two halves, and then each heminucleus is chopped and aspirated. While chopping, you have to create a vacuum seal. How will you create a vacuum seal? First, the foot position, the foot is in position one, then your tip is inside the eye. Get the tip close to the nucleus. In position two, just embed the tip into the nucleus. Then you go to position three, you bury the tip and impale it with the nucleus with very short burst of phaco. Then you come back to position two. Here, such vacuum hold is created. In the figure, as you see, in the first, here vacuum seal is good, but here vacuum seal not good, because during position three, they used more ultrasound energy, so the nucleus got emulsified at the tip, so the vacuum hold was not good. Direct chop. In direct chop, no trenching is done. The nucleus is directly chopped. This is the chop mode. This is chop mode parameters. Aspiration flow rate is 25 to 30 cc per minute. There should be high vacuum, and the power is around 40 to 50%. There are two types of chop, horizontal and vertical chop. In horizontal chop, basically, horizontal force is created. As you see in this figure, first you embed the phaco tip into the nucleus, then you take the chopper is moved under the rexus margin around the equator, and then chopper is moved towards the phaco tip in horizontal direction. Once it is close to the tip, you move apart and break the nucleus. And then chop it like that, chop in all quadrants and aspirate the nucleus. Vertical chop. Vertical chop mainly uses vertical force or shearing force. Here, same, the phaco probe is embedded into the nucleus, creating a vacuum seal. And then chopper is placed close to the phaco probe, and vertical force is created, chopper in downward direction and phaco tip forces in upward direction, shearing force created, and the nucleus is split. Epinucleus removal. In epinucleus removal, the instrument...
One thing you have to take care in horizontal chop, that you have to be very careful not to hitch the capsule. And that problem is not there with the vertical chop. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. Epinucleus removal. The instruments used are phaco tip and iris repositories. The settings are high flow, moderate vacuum, and low power. The technique used is chip and flip. Chip and flip means you chip the epinucleus with the tip first, anterior epinucleus, and then you leave a tongue of anterior epinucleus, and with the probe you flip the epinucleus towards posteriorly, and then you aspirate the epinucleus. Cortical aspiration. Cortical aspiration is done by two methods. Either you can use coaxial irrigation aspiration handpiece or bimanual handpiece. Coaxial handpiece can be straight or angulated. Aspiration orifice is at the tip. There is only one aspiration orifice at the tip. Aspiration orifice is at the tip. Tip is covered with sleeve with two holes in the sleeve. In bimanual irrigation aspiration system, the irrigation handpiece has two holes and the aspiration one has one hole. You go to the periphery to the equator and catch the base of the cortex and then pulled towards the center with port facing the cortex as per the cortex. To repeat on the opposite side with change of hands. The aspiration flow rate should be 25 to 30 cc per minute and vacuum limit is 400 mmHg. There is no power used in cortical aspiration. And capsule polishing can also be done. This is done to reduce PCO. There should be very low vacuum and flow. Should focus on PC, stretch the PC with visco so that no holes are present. Eye wall insertion. In eye wall insertion, first fill the eye with viscoelastic. For non-foldable PMMA IOL, you use 2 McPherson forceps to introduce IOL into the eye. For foldable IOL, you can use holder folder methods or there are injectors available now. You can put the lens onto the injector and then inject. Visco wash. Visco wash is done in IA mode. Ensure that visco is washed fully to prevent post-op rise in IOP. And at last, you can tap over the center of IOL to release any visco present in the back. And wound is closed by stromal hydration. There should be adequate stromal hydration so that the inner lip is sealed. In doubt of leakage, suture can be taken. Here is a video of phaco emulsification surgery by Dr. Vibian ma'am. This will be explained by Dr. Vibian ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. Ma'am?
Thanks, Amulya.
Yeah. Can I play the video?
Can you please play the video?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am.
So we start with taking a good brittle suture and a superior conjunctival peritomy, about say 4 to 6 clacars, and then 5 to 5.5 millimeter groove is made. And here, if you see, can I pause the video a little?
Yes, yes, you are. Okay, ma'am.
I'll go back. Yeah, yes. Here, the tunnel is made after the groove is made about 5 to 5.5 millimeter, 2 millimeter behind the limbus. And your tunnel should be exactly like a rectangular tunnel produces more astigmatism, whereas a square tunnel is supposed to produce lesser astigmatism. But here, because the groove being a little larger size, it's difficult to achieve a square tunnel. So once you place the crescent, you achieve a proper plane through which you move the crescent. And once you reach the dome of the cornea, you gently lift the tip of the crescent to produce a sideways movement and achieve your tunnel. Okay. And you should not be entering premature inside the eye because the tip and the sides of the crescent both are very sharp. So once you start doing this and achieve a proper tunnel, you can start making your side folds. Initially, this case was recorded long back, and I don't know why I did my tunnel first, but we usually do your side port and rexis first and then do your scleral tunnel. Okay, yeah, please play the video. And the side ports are made at a 15 degree, about say 2-3 clockers away from your limbus, and keep it a little down initially because in case you have to convert your section, it will be easier for you to convert into SICS, and you initiate your rexis. Once you initiate your rexis, you have to produce a radial tear, CCC, which means see where you are producing the radial tear, see where you are producing your fold, and see where you are folding. You should fold at the edge of the flap and keep rotating the flap following the contour of the pupillary margin. You should not be tearing it across, and it should be a centripetal force towards the center and neither drag the flap. Dragging, it should be with the operata. With cystitone, you are basically rolling the flap and don't churn the cortex. That way, you will achieve a good rexis. And now, the keratometry. Keratometry is done with a 3.2 keratome here because we are going to place a rigid IOL, produce a dimple, and then enter and take off the flap. So, hydro procedures like previously explained, go through the main wound, and then if you want, you can supplement through the side port. Produce a nice fluid wave, always burp the nucleus, decompress, and so that the nucleus should not prolapse. With overhydro, the nucleus will prolapse and your surgery will get messy. And every time, we should not build the negative pressure inside the bag. So you should always decompress the nucleus after every procedure of hydro. Here, it's a dense nucleus, so I've done only hydro dissection and limited delineation. I'm going for sculpt and chop now. So initial, after entering the eye, fix the globe with your left hand repositor and start sculpting. Once you start sculpting, take off the visco and then start because it reduces the thermal conduction to the wound and reduces the wound burns. What happened?
1 second. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So thermal conduction is reduced and your own burns are reduced. So if you see there, I start from the center and keep going down, engaging about the 2/3 of the tip, and I always see my bevel, where is the bevel, so that you can see what you are catching. And towards the center, you can afford to go a little deeper. Towards the periphery, lift the probe a little so that not to catch the rexus, but good enough to trench. Once you achieve a good width and depth, you rotate and crack the nucleus into two halves. You can either do it vertically or horizontally, whichever way it's comfortable for you. One, and the crack has to be complete. The posterior port has to be flat cracked. Can you pause a little?
Yes, ma'am.
Here, once you hold, you build up your vacuum and foot switch 3. Okay, build up a vacuum and foot, impale the nucleus with the ultrasound power, and come back to IA, mobilize the piece, and then bring to the center for quadrant removal. So chopping, what you do, once you crack the piece into two halves, you hold the inferior hemisphere with your probe with a high vacuum, say about 350 to 400 vacuum, and impale the probe with the nucleus, and to put your dilute to the periphery and bring it towards the probe and separate horizontally. That will achieve a nice crack. There is karate chop, and there is another chop which we bring the brings the nucleus, which is a modified karate chop, which brings the nucleus outside of the back and cracks, which is a little difficult and dangerous. You better hitch the probe, the dialer or the chopper in the middle of the nucleus where it is more dense, and you can crack on sideways so that you can achieve a nice horizontal chop. The choppers are very, there is a blunted chop, sharp edge choppers are there, and there is a chopper which is sharp on all the edges, so we are tapered ones. So you should be very careful which chopper you are taking. I still, today I use only the dialers which are blunted. And it's easy to chop any kind of nucleus in a horizontal chop is a little safer than a vertical chop. But it anyway depends on the experience of the surgeon. Yeah, please play. So once one quadrant is removed, the remaining quadrants, it's easy to take. So first quadrant, you have to mobilize from the back to the center and then start eating the pieces. Stay in the central safe zone and at least in the pupillary plane, and don't go into the anterior chamber or towards PC too much. You can divide it into multiple pieces and then take the each individual piece for quadrant removal. But the settings are almost the same, like 40 to 60 power and 300 to 400 vacuum, depending upon the density of the nucleus. And aspiration flow rate will be around 30 cc for quadrant removal. So once you mobilize each piece, see that every single piece is separated well and hanging loose in the bag, and then only it's better to take the pieces. For the last piece, I always decrease the parameters so that it is safe and your surge is also reduced. Like Dr. CKP said, always when the piece is getting towards, you're eating away the piece towards the end, gently lift up your foot switch so that you come back to irrigation so that your tip doesn't get repulsed with the piece and gets eaten up well. So that is for your quadrant removal. So once the quadrant removal is done, here it was a dense cataract, so not much of epinucleus was left. So I proceeded with the cortical wash. Cortical wash, again, the vacuum is almost the same. Probably can you keep a higher vacuum of 500 also, because the caliber of the aspiration port is a little smaller than your PECO probe. So we do a high vacuum, hold the periphery, catch the piece, come to center, turn the port up and aspirate by bringing your foot switch down. Mechanically occlude the cortex and then increase the vacuum. Don't keep in irrigation, only in irrigation should be going towards the cortex and not in IA. Okay, that will collapse the chamber more. So this is when you should always be very careful whether you're completed with your cortical wash, any cortical remnants or remaining in the tunnel and all that. And next comes your keratome extension. This is a 5.2 keratome where you can hold the globe and then insert the keratome and extend on sideways on both sides to insert a rigid IOL. So here comes the breaking news from the OT boy telling that you have either inserted the IOL safely inside the eye, or we are being wanted in the OT for inspecting the eye. This is when, before insert, can you pause a little? Yes, so before inserting the IOL, please always check where is the pupil, any tinting or lifting of the peaking of pupil is there, any denting up of rexus margin, any abnormal lines, the stress lines are seen in the PCE, or the rexus should be in place where you have done. The rexus is hanging in one place or thrown into folds, the bag is thrown into folds. That is when it should occur to you that you have produced a zonal dehiscence during cortical wash or during some other maneuver or a PCR. And you gently inject your visco and see to stretch the PC. there are multiple telltale signs which tells you that there is a PCR or zonular dehiscence. If you inject visco, the PC should stretch beautifully, and the visco should be retained in the chamber. Otherwise, it will be going like a whirlpool into the vit cavity. Can you literally see it entering into the vit cavity if you inject the visco, if it's in the central PCR or superior or inferior PCR. So at that point, before inserting the lens, always check whether the plexus and the PC is well intact. Okay, and then place your rigid IOL or foldable IOL for that matter. Yeah, play man. So hold the optic at the junction and insert the inferior leading haptic into the plexus, and then dilate, or you can even rotate the optic and place it just under the plexus. Leave it and dial and check. Dialing always should be done under supervision in the beginning, because that is when you again give the breaking news. And always check whether it is in the bag. When you're putting a 5.5 optic in the sulcus, it will not stay. If you're going to put it in you have to take a bigger optic if you're going to put it in sulcus. 5.5 optic is meant for in the bag placement. So you have to always check whether you have placed the IOL in the bag. So how will you check? You have to tend the excess margin with the dialer under visco cover and check. If you're able to feel the excess margin at the tip of the haptic, then you are placed in the bag. Yeah. Then do a thorough cortical wash and then visco wash. Yeah, and then close your wound, side port hydro, and check your wound, and then close the conjunctiva. So finally, it is the not only the procedure, it's the surgery starts with your pre-op evaluation. Check the DBR, whether the IOL is the same IOL, whether there is any varying, and if there is a visual acuity is correlating to the density of the cataract, and always check whether it is a low axial length or a higher axial length. Okay, and the ideal cases only will be given to you. And duct, especially whether it is any duct patency, look for dry eyes, because dry eyes itself will produce changes in DBR. And cataract density and dilatation, these are the 5 Ds which you have to thoroughly check. Always check the eye, check the patient, and do a proper pre-op evaluation. With that, a good knowledge of PECO machine, a watertight astigmatically neutral wound, and of course centrally adequate CCC with an optimum power modulation and fluidics according to your density of cataract, plus mastering the technique, will provide a dream PECO outcome. These 5 things you can always achieve in wet lab, and then moving on to your PECO or directly to your PECO. But for one thing which carries home is your post-op management also. You should be always learn a few lines to tell your patient, talk to them, and answer their queries on table, and make it a point to go and visit them in the ward and next day post-operative care, which is most essential. Okay. Thank you all.
These are my references. And thank you, Dr. Vibian ma'am, Dr. Kishina ma'am, and Dr. Katie.
In the long class, do we have some questions? I mean, do we have time for some questions, or is it okay if we want to discuss? It's up to you, because it's already 6 o'clock. If anybody is game, I have a few questions with me. RP sir, KKV ma'am.
Yeah, wonderful. Enjoyed the class, really. Such a thorough presentation, and you guided the class so well.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Okay, a few quick questions. Is it okay, or should we wind up the class?
Why not? Just maybe one
it's
or
already
two.
Six. Okay. No, I just wanted to know, anybody has an experience with the White Star Signature Pro, which has both the dual pumps, the peristaltic and the venturi pump. So any experience with that, and how is the chop, and what are the settings in those machines? How do you go about with those machines?
Oh, questions to us? I have questions.
Yes, ma'am. It's already over. They are out of zone.
Yeah, it's actually a very heavy class. I don't know. Since I haven't used it. I once used it. That's it. So not enough to explain anything, actually. Maybe Rajesh?
Okay, I think VR sir uses it more. I think Signature was Navsuja for a longer time.
Navsuja.
Yeah, okay.
I'm also not very much used to White Star.
Okay. So, any pointers for chopping, sir? Because whenever I asked them to, recently the REH machine conked off. So, I asked for the next Infinity. They told the OT boy gave me a look and said, sir, only uses chop, madam. So, I said, no, give me the other setting then. So what is your pointers for chop, like the direct chop or vertical chop? What do you use?
Yeah, the tip to how to start chopping. So first, everybody should master the basics of four quadrants and shouldn't be thinking about chopping. So to understand the fluidics and the foot pedal control, it's always good to stick to the basics until they don't get any complication and they are sure of their foot position and how to manage surge, small pupil, shallow anterior chamber, or cataract. Till they reach that stage, they needn't bother about to chop because it will come automatically once they know the fluid and the machine. So start with for chopping, it is good to go for the Vasavada technique. So okay. Dr. Vasavada, he does a long trench, vertical trench, and cracks into the two pieces. And then he takes the Zinsky and chops each pieces. And okay. He doesn't remove that. And then after chopping the each halves into multiple pieces, each one is about 4 to 5 pieces each half, so about 8 to 10 pieces, then he starts removing one by one. So once everybody is used to this, and then they can use the Dublin Indo-German chopper, which has the horizontal part as well as the vertical part. So horizontal part is good for the soft cataract, and vertical is for the hard cataract. So advantage with this is there is no offsetting the total power used is minimal, and when there is no pulsating, the time duration is also comes down. Mm-hmm. And for soft cataract, when the trenching and cracking becomes difficult, mm-hmm. the horizontal chopper will be very helpful to chop and divide.
Okay.
Yeah, if people follow this step by step, automatically they can transit into the chopper without any complication and difficulty.
Thank you, sir. Avis, ma'am, what's your pointers for a runaway rexus? Whenever the rexus runs away, my heart also goes along with it. So, what's your pointers, ma'am, for rexus, runaway rexus?
Don't allow it to run away, I guess. Watch the rexus diameter. The best way to correct it is before it runs away to peripheral, because once it reaches anterior zonules, then you'll find it difficult to bring it back. As the diameter of the rexus starts enlarging, you should stop, form the chamber again, and then redirect the already raised flap more centripetally so that whatever force you are applying, the sector, the vector force is not into the zonules. Then you should take it around.
Okay.
Deep anterior chamber is very essential. If you are pressing on your side port also, the AC is going to shallow and that is going to take your excess out.
So when do you ideally convert, ma'am? So if you're not able to, do you change your instruments from Cystitone to Ultrata or micro rexus forceps?
If you are still in your learning process, then any time the rexus is not behaving, it is better we convert out of FACO itself. But if somebody is comfortable with rexus, once they are really confident, 50-100 surgeries, uncomplicated in a row they have done, when that level of FACO skill has been achieved, it means that they have the capacity to maintain their chamber, have a foot pedal control, all that is in place. When that is the case, then if it has gone to the zonules, we have two options. Either use the cystitome itself or switch over to an Ultrata or a forceps. The cystitome, you can try. If it has just kissed the zonules, then you can use the cystitome to release the zonules which are actually tugging on the anterior capsule. And before all that, apart from deepening the anterior chamber, magnify. Because then only you can see the exact zonules that are holding the cut-uncut junction. So if you can release, isolatedly release those zonules, then you can still use your cystitome and curl it back in. If that doesn't work, then you have the option of using an Ultrata, or nowadays you have a capsule-holding forceps. The advantage of the capsule-holding forceps is that you can use your side port rather than the main wound, whereas Ultrata will need either an enlarged side port or the main wound because the forceps is a little fatter. Then, because the Ultrata or the forceps does not use the counterforce of the zonules, it is having a ripping action, you will still be able to break the zonules and drag the rexus in. But then your direction of movement has to completely change to a centripetal pull, whereas this would have been a parallel to the iris kind of a movement. So the direction of your movement also has to change. If this also doesn't work, then the last option is to make a nick on the other side, start your excess in the clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, then bring it to that point and end it there. At that point, either you can, sometimes it gets completed, or you may have to use a forceps or a vanas to cut it, scissors or vanas to cut it. But you should always remember that that is a weak point. Anytime the rexus margin can go behind and split your posterior capsule into two. That is why all these gimmicks, if you want to do, it should be done only by people like the moderator. Who can manage not for the presenter. Can I have few points in the class? Excellent class, first of all. Amulya has managed to digest a class. That's something impressive. And Parmeshwari and Veena have done a wonderful job. It was very nice and complete and thoroughly done. A couple of things is, one, you were talking about the cavitation and the jackhammer effect, no? The jackhammer effect, the thing that breaks the cataract is much more the cavitational force rather than the jackhammer effect. We all think that the jackhammer is actually breaking the cataract, but it's pounding the cataract, but when the tip moves back, there is an acute vacuum that is created in that area of the tip, and that vacuum actually causes the cataract to crumble. So that is why if you have too fast a movement of the tip, you don't give enough time for the cavitational collapse of the cataract. So it will the cavitational component is much more important in breaking and softening the nucleus. That's one. Second, the just a curiosity question, Amulya. You said no, the tips are the irrigating holes are 180 degrees apart.
Yes, ma'am.
Why are they on either side? Why not like a Simcoe in the front or in one place? Because it has to do with the fluidics of the eye. Because you're operating in a closed chamber, when the tip is in front, right? So you have a cataract in front of the tip. So when the fluid is along with the tip, then the cataract will keep moving away. So whereas in Simcoe, in cataract surgery, we reduce the flow so that the cortex and the flow are balanced. Whereas here, if you reduce the flow, then the heat will build up and the heat will burn the cornea and the endothelium. So you need a certain amount of flow. But if you maintain the flow 180 degrees apart, the flow comes out, hits the 3 and 9 o'clock angle, and the fluid then flows towards 6 o'clock where your suction is going on. In that process, it sweeps the cataract into the tip of the probe. So actually, it helps the mobilization of the cataract into the tip. And that is why the sleeve holes through which the fluid comes out are 180 degrees apart. Many times when sisters give you the tip, they don't watch that. So you need to watch it before you enter the eye. Then next is the torsional and transverse movement, ellipsoid movement and all. They apply to both, to all the Kelman tips can have a torsional movement. But the ellipsoid movement is classical of the AMO machines. And so it is, you can have it in both the straight tips as well as the Kelman tip. And the advantage is that because here you have to have the cavitational and the jackhammer force occurring to emulsify the cataract, this sideways movement also, whenever the tip is moving from left to right, throughout the action, there is going to be breaking of the cataract. So they say it is causes faster emulsification when compared to the jackhammer movement. And as a beginner, which would you prefer, a pulse mode or a burst mode? You talk about a pulse and a burst, right? You say that the burst is better.
The pulse mode is preferred.
Why? Sounds like CKP.
No.
Amulya only?
Yeah, Amulya.
Why do you prefer a pulse over a burst? What is the advantage?
Actually, phaco power can be, by linear mode, phaco power can be controlled.
So what is the advantage? Because in both, if you press, you're going to reach the full amount. It gives you enough reaction time. When it is a pulse mode, it is a graded increase from 0 to 50 or whatever is your setting. And so you have enough time for the probe to enter into the cataract and impale the cataract. So for a beginner, if you keep a burst mode, because the burst every time is going to deliver an equal amount of energy into the cataract, you may eat through the cataract because the beginner is also going to operate on an NS2 or an NS3. That's why, in general, if you operate on a tense cataract, you can blindly go for a burst mode because whatever energy you're delivering the full setting amount. So you will be able to impale the cataract, but at the same time, you won't eat through the cataract. Whereas in pulse mode, it will give you a little time, reaction time to impale into the cataract. So however experienced you are, you will never use a burst mode for a softish cataract, NS1 or NS2. Okay, you have to use it only for denser cataracts because you can eat through.
Yes, thanks.
Then what is plume and what is overlocking? My two favorite questions.
Ma'am?
What is plume? Surgical plume in phaco? Phaco plume?
I don't know.
Okay, plume is many times you see it, one smoky thing comes as you're trenching. You'll see it in many of our, when we are all struggling also, you'll see one smoky thing at the tip and then the smoke disappears. That is the plume. It's like a bomb, no? The plume comes out. So that plume is actually pulverized cataract. So if you are having too much of a plume, especially if you are having an NS2 or an NS3 and when you're trenching, you see a smoky thing at the tip, it means one thing. It means that the aspiration is not adequate. It is not able to remove, I mean, vacuum is not adequate or the inflow of fluid into the anterior chamber is not adequate because the pulverized cataract is sitting in the anterior chamber. One, the risk is for you, you lose your visualization so you can eat through the cataract. But for the patient, it is fine shards of nucleus sitting there, so it will completely spoil the endothelium. And it can also mean that soon you're going to develop a wound burn. So if you see a plume, confirm that the fluid flowing is okay. There's no tenting of your irrigation tubing. The aspiration flow is okay. The tube, there is no blockage either in the tubing or within the phaco probe. A couple of times you trench and still you get the plume. It's time to come out and flush the entire system, reprime it before you start your surgery. And what is overlocking? Anybody? O-A-R-O, overlocking. Anyone? It occurs whenever you have a long tunnel. What happens is if your either your corneal entry is too anterior or you start too posterior on your sclera, the length of the tunnel increases. Because the length of the tunnel increases, when you insert your probe, you're not able to move the probe sideways around. So the probe gets locked inside a long tunnel. If you want to even go a little to the left or the right to catch a piece, you'll produce so much of corneal distortion and striae. And if it is long, sometimes the irrigation gets also trapped within the tunnel. It can hydrate the tunnel, it can cause desmos detachment, and it can throw a lot of corneal folds that will completely spoil your visualization of the anterior chamber. So overlocking is when, you know, is when you're locking the ore, how you'll put it into that slot and it gets fixed. So the probe mobility gets affected. That is overlocking. And one last thing about venturi and peristaltic pump. You were telling, no, the venturi pump, that is theory. When venturi pumps are faster and peristaltic pumps are slower, and peristaltic pump is considered safer than a venturi pump. But actually, if you see Infinity, Centurion, everything, all the present machines are all peristaltic pumps. The technology has changed adequately for the peristaltic pumps to give you as much safety and speed as a venturi pump. And that is done because as per what you told, no, that is what you should tell at your level. Whenever the occlusion is lost, the peristaltic pump, the vacuum drops to zero, right?
Yes, ma'am.
But here they keep a preset vacuum. So whatever drop, vacuum is lost, still the preset vacuum never drops to zero. It stays at 30 or 50 or whatever. So you will never have that kind of a surge or that kind of a collapse occurring. And the disadvantage of a lower end machine, peristaltic pump like an Appasamy or something, is that unless you can induce a complete occlusion of the tip to the cataract, you can never build the vacuum. So you'll never get a hold. Every time you try to catch a piece, you'll eat one hole in the cataract and then the cataract piece is gone. So you can easily go through the cataract into the epinucleus or the capsule. So unless you have a good foot pedal control, a peristaltic pump is actually, a lower end machine is actually much more difficult for a novice than a venturi pump. But because venturis are a little faster than peristaltics, this is the thing that is told, which is what you have to write in your exams also. That's all.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Very nice class.
Thank you, ma'am.
Nice class. Thank you. Nice hearing all your voices also.
Thank you. Congrats, Amulya. Great class.
Excellent.
Sir, want to tell something, sir?
Yes, ma'am, I've told. So, there is always a delay in the delivery of the phaco power after we press the foot switch. So we should be get used to that the lag, because by mistake we will think that we have not delivered and will press once again. So as we saw the figure, the off cycle interval keeps coming down as we press the foot pedal downwards, and it narrows and becomes together, and it will be more energy will be delivered. So this has to be remembered during usage of burst mode. Otherwise, it will go through the piece and can cause complications. I just want to tell that.
Okay, sir.
Just few points, practical points. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Very nice class. Few points, like whenever you enter the globe with the probe, we always say irrigation on, and see to it that you depress the lip and go inside and don't carry the cornea also inside. There's more chances of DM detachment during that stage. And second thing is, while cracking, ensure that the center is also cracked, because many times you will feel that after cracking all four quadrants, you feel you have cracked fully, but center, if it is not cracked, then the whole piece will come towards the probe and you will be doing only the anterior chamber phaco. So that is more common in diabetic cataract because the posterior plate is very leathery. So ensure that the crack is complete. And while the quadrant removal, see that whenever there's epinucleus covering the piece, so remove the epinucleus, push away the epinucleus with your second instrument and eat only the pieces. And so that you'll have a cushion at the end of the, after eating all the pieces, you'll have a epinucleus bowl which you can eat it easily. Yeah. That's the thing I wanted to tell. Very nice, class.
Okay, thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, Amulya, for the wonderful presentation. And thank you, Ladies Ma'am and RK Sir and Jaya for adding your things in the presentation. Thank you, Amulya, and we will wind up the class.
Thank you.